Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Priest by David Beers, narrated by Joe Hempel. Part 1. The Book of Genesis. Chapter 1. Lucy Speckle stared at the television, her attention focused entirely on it, not noticing the small ticks that broke out across her face from time to time. The people around her didn't notice either, but it wasn't because they were focused on the TV like Lucy. They had other issues. We are here today to commemorate an FBI agent whose name many of you probably already know. His accomplishments are nearly legend, and we are all lucky to have him helping keep our citizens safe. We'd like to present Luke Titan with our highest award. Lucy didn't know the man speaking, and she didn't care about him either. He was non-essential. Lucy believed heavily in the essential and the non-essential. Anything that didn't fit into the first bucket could be discarded without further thought, and in Lucy's mind there was only a single essential guiding force, the one true God of Abraham and Isaac. Yet despite the non-essentialness of the man speaking, she couldn't pull herself away from the screen. She wasn't looking at him, though, or the person he appeared to be speaking about. Lucy watched someone on the back left. His hands were folded in front of him, and he looked uncomfortable in his suit and tie. To Lucy Speckle, it was clear he didn't want to be on stage. "Who is that?" Lucy asked, her voice snapping out across the room's silence, her normal stutter missing. "Lucy, please stay calm," someone non-essential said from her side. For the most part, all the people working here were non-essential. They didn't serve God, but the government. An evil thing that Lucy had no time for. She knew God would get her out of this wretched place sooner or later. He had put her here for a reason, and if she didn't understand it yet, she trusted him implicitly. But now, staring at the television screen, perhaps she'd found the reason. The man standing on stage, to the left. How long had the preacher spoken about this moment? For how many years had her and Daddy, and Mama, though to a far lesser degree, prayed for worthiness, to be shown exactly what Lucy now saw? "Who is that?" She stood, ignoring the orderly next to her, and watched the television, placing her hand directly on the man. "Who is he?" She looked around the room, but she saw only blank faces. "What is his name?" Lucy was growing angry at these people, the fact that no one would answer her. "His name is Christian Windsor," another orderly said. Three more non-essentials had come into the room ready to calm Lucy Speckle if she couldn't do it herself. "He's an FBI agent." There, that was all she needed. Lucy stepped a few feet back from the television and stared at Christian Windsor. Even the name seemed godly. Her right eyebrow twitched upward and her head jerked down slightly before regaining its usual place. Lucy didn't notice. She stared at the screen for a long time until the ceremony ended and the next show started. Only then did she break her concentration. Lucy walked to a corner in the large room and found a chair away from everyone else. She sat and thought about the man on TV. The next few weeks were turbulent ones for Lucy. She often found herself angry at those around her, which meant she ended up in one of those jackets that wouldn't let her move. They called it a straitjacket. She called it fucking bullshit, one of the few times Lucy Speckle used such language, and then she spat at the orderlies who put it on her. God didn't like curse words, but Daddy had used them when he was mad, though he always repented. They were non-essentials, but she still couldn't help the anger she felt toward them. She shouldn't be in here, not with all the rest of these crazies. She didn't know how long she had been here. She hadn't been good at keeping up with the time since Daddy died. But now that she had seen Christian Windsor, she knew she'd been here too long. No one ever visited her, and that was more than fine. She didn't want to talk with anyone. Not her family, though they all pretty much disowned Daddy decades ago. Lucy never really had any friends. She didn't need any besides God, and he was always with her. Those weeks were awful, especially when locked away inside the straitjacket, because she felt God trying to speak, but she couldn't hear him well inside this place. It was like the walls were built with a material that kept God out. Lucy knew that couldn't possibly be true, that the God of Abraham did whatever he wanted, when he wanted. Perhaps the walls simply interfered with her ability to hear him. That made more sense. Either way, the result was the same. Lucy knew that the person she had seen on the television screen, Christian Windsor, was the one her and Daddy, actually the whole church, had been searching for. But she wanted more confirmation. Finally, Lucy quit fighting the orderlies and doctors that came around. Just as she had realized years ago how non-essential the kids mocking her at school were, she understood that fighting these non-essentials was keeping God at bay. So she lay down on her bed and quit caring about this ephemeral world, which was only a test from God, and one she had to rise above. She urinated and defecated on herself during this time. Her eyes never left the ceiling. She didn't move at all when the orderlies came to change her clothes, her arms and legs pliable as they undressed and redressed her. Only a few more hours would pass before more bodily functions occurred, and the orderlies had to do it all again. She didn't care, truthfully. She didn't even notice. Lucy had gone to God. For once, she was able to do it without the instruments Daddy had given her. God was talking to her. And in the end, it was glorious because Lucy finally understood Daddy hadn't been lying all those years. They had been chosen, even if Daddy wasn't here to see it. The non-essential fell away for good, leaving only room for the essential. And that was Christian Windsor. He was what God wanted for Lucy Speckle, what this whole hellish world had been about, to prepare her for him. God's sword. Chapter 2. 2 years later. I'm hungry, Christian said. When are you not? Tommy Phillips, one of Christian's partners at the FBI, asked. You're disgusting, Luke Titan, the third in the trio, said. The three of them stared at a body, but Christian was used to such comments from the other two. He couldn't help it when he got hungry. Plus, it was lunchtime. We shouldn't be here anyway. These guys are just lazy. Christian saw Tommy shaking his head and quickly realized the snafu. Christian was talking about the police officers who had called them down here, and they happened to still be in the room. Christian looked up from the body. I'm sorry. I have a problem. The three cops in front of him only stared, not kindly. None said a word. Christian looked back down at the body, determined to try and keep his mouth shut for the rest of this endeavor. I'm sorry about Agent Windsor. He operates a bit differently. But while I don't agree with his sentiment, I don't think this is something our group would take over. Of course it isn't, Christian thought. The body in front of them was clearly killed by gang members. They had cut the tongue out, so the police immediately wanted to classify it as a pathological crime, which could possibly fall under the FBI's purview. Most of the time, cops simply didn't want to deal with the paperwork, so they tried to shove things off on Christian's group. Thanks for your time, Tommy said. If you need anything from us, please don't hesitate to call. After the perfunctory handshakes, which Christian was blessedly left out of, he hated trying to keep up with society's etiquette. The three of them left the room and walked upstairs, exiting the morgue. Well, that was nice of you, Christian, Luke said, smiling. You just keep making friends. If you two would have simply taken me to lunch, I wouldn't have said anything else. I'm not doing subs, Tommy said, and it'll be the fourth time this week. Luke, what do you want? I'm indifferent. Damn it, Tommy said. He looked at Christian. No subs. Pick something else. Chinese? Fine. The three of them got into their car and pulled out of the parking lot. They didn't spend many days like this, heading to police stations or morgues where the crimes shown had nothing to do with their division. But they did it more than any of them wanted to. 2 years had passed since the surgeon made national news. Christian always thought of him as Bradley Brown, and even though Luke ended up saving Tommy and Christian by putting a bullet through Bradley's face, Christian felt a sense of sorrow for the man. He was dead, and his eyeless mother in a state-run home now. But Christian had seen what happened to turn a young kid into such a horrible monster. Tommy and Luke could discount Bradley's early life before he began his murder spree, but Christian couldn't. The cases they worked now were mostly dead ends, one-time murders. They hadn't found any cults, any serial killers, or any truly crazy people in the past 2 years. There were a few up north and a few out west, but the southeast region had been relatively quiet. "Are either of you getting bored?" He saw Luke's small grin. He automatically knew what Christian was asking about. Their connection had grown stronger over the past 2 years. It was their intelligence, both of them having minds which maneuvered at ferocious speeds that most others couldn't even imagine. The thoughts Christian had about Luke 2 years ago never crossed his mind anymore, that Luke might have been a murderer. It was the only time in Christian's 28 years that his mind had missed something. Bradley Brown's obsession with Luke, which drove Christian's brain to make connections that didn't actually exist. "Bored of what?" Tommy asked. "Of the job." "Ready to transfer out?" Tommy said. The thought had never occurred to Christian. He couldn't imagine life without the two people in the front seats, no more than he could imagine life without his mother or his psychiatrist. These two were his family, his friends, and Christian couldn't fathom replacing them. "No, why would I do that?" "You know that at some point we will all leave this division, right?" Luke said. "It's amazing that the three of us are still here after 2 years. The director's actually pressuring Luke right now to take another position." "Waverly?" Christian asked. "Yes, sir. He wants Luke to take over the West Coast, dealing with violent crimes that cross state lines, primarily gang-related offenses." Christian was stunned. Somehow, despite all his intelligence, he hadn't considered that they might go their separate ways. "Are you going to take it?" "No, I don't think so." "Luke is an idiot, if you haven't noticed," Tommy said. "However, he may be the only person in the FBI who can pass up an opportunity like that and not have to worry. They'll always be trying to move him up the ranks, which gives him leeway to accept what he wants." "So when something better comes for you, you'll jump ship?" Christian said. "Jump ship?" Tommy said. "You know we get a pension, and it's based on how high our salary is when we retire. I want some pretty big paychecks when I retire. You should too." Christian fell silent. He originally thought he would stay with the FBI for 10 years or so and then use his dual doctorates for other endeavors. He hadn't considered that plan in years, though. Somehow, in his mind, he figured the three of them would ride this thing out until... Until what? Until they died or retired? "Hey," Tommy said, "no one's leaving to go anywhere yet. And when we do, it's not like we can't still see each other. Don't worry about it. Nothing's happened and nothing's going to happen for the foreseeable future." Telling Christian not to worry about something was like telling an alcoholic to put down his drink, though, and everyone in the car knew it. Luke watched Christian poke a fork into his fried rice. He refused to eat with chopsticks, saying they were the largest form of idiocy he could imagine. "If an alien species comes down and finds us using two sticks to eat our food, they'll kill us on general principle." Luke hated the food in these places, and all the places that Tommy and Christian chose to eat. He came and he ate, though, because Luke was concerned only with the long term. He had always thought that way, but now it was more important than ever. He knew why Christian wasn't eating, because the boy was upset about the possibility of the band breaking up. His normally prodigious appetite was stunted while he dwelt on it. Luke wasn't going to let the band go anywhere, though, even if he couldn't tell Christian that. Luke turned down the position he was offered for that exact reason. It wasn't the first offer Waverly had presented to him, and it wouldn't be the last. Luke Titan was widely viewed as the most talented FBI agent in the entire organization. Tommy was right. If anyone else had turned down such an offer, their career would be dead in the water. More offers would come for Luke, although he didn't care in the slightest. This team, this band, was what mattered to him. But for very different reasons than it did Christian. 2 years had passed for Luke without sufficient opportunity to continue his plans. The crimes they investigated simply weren't big enough on a scale which would create the confusion and chaos he desired. Bradley Brown had almost been large enough. But in the end, Luke relented and killed the psychopath, saving the very people he had set up in the first place. He received his medal and the gratitude of the entire FBI, despite the fact that Christian Windsor and Tommy Phillips were tied up in Bradley Brown's house because of Luke Titan. "You're really worrying about what I said in the car, aren't you?" Tommy asked. "Yes," Christian said. "Why, man? I just told you no one is going anywhere." "But you will, eventually." "But when? We don't know, so why sit here and worry about it?" Tommy said. Christian didn't respond. Luke took a bite of his food, not looking at the boy. He still thought of him like that, as a boy, although he felt a certain fondness for him. Perhaps Christian and Tommy were right. Maybe Luke had been waiting too long. His chaos could start at any time. Was he enjoying this? Their company? In some way, perhaps yes, but that didn't mean one could deny their purpose. Yes, maybe it was time to begin. "How are you feeling today?" Luke asked. Veronica Lopez thought it odd how easily she switched from calling him Dr. Titan to Luke over the past 2 years. Odd because this began as strictly professional, but now she considered him a friend. Maybe it shouldn't seem odd. Isn't that what always happened when you were around someone long enough? She'd seen Luke every month over the past 2 years, her therapy beginning with Bradley Brown but expanding much further. "I'm doing okay, I guess. Stress from work." "What kind of stress?" They sat in Luke's spacious living room, he on a large leather chair and she on the couch catty-corner to it. The man knew how to decorate, that was obvious. The couch felt like clouds beneath her, and it never ceased to amaze. She wanted to ask him how much it cost, but never did. "I don't know what I'm going to write next," she said, answering his question. "Well, we could always arrange to have another killer trap you." Luke gave a slight smirk. "Hard pass." She was okay with his jokes now that she understood his personality. Luke saw everything in a different light. Some people wore dark sunglasses and others wore rose-colored ones, with most switching between the two depending on the situation. Luke saw the world with a perfect, bright clarity, the sun's light illuminating everything. It gave him an ability to dismiss emotions, Veronica supposed, to a large degree. It also made him effective at therapy. "You still haven't picked up any other patients?" "No, I don't have enough time. You're the only woman in my life, Veronica." Still smiling. "Have you thought about going back to the book on the sphere?" The sphere, the book that had led her to all of this, to Luke Titan and his world, to Christian Windsor, Tommy Phillips, and ending with Bradley fucking Brown. "It's dead. They stopped working on it." The sphere had been Luke Titan's invention back when he was in academia, before switching careers to the FBI, his third career change. Psychiatrist, astrophysicist, and finally special agent. You were, apparently, the engine that kept it moving. You could write about that. I always love good press. You could start working on it again. That would give me something to write on. Maybe I will one day. Not today, though, Luke said. They sat quietly for a few seconds. Luke did this often, letting silence dominate until she was forced to speak. I've got to write something, I just don't know what. Well, what are your talents? What do you mean? She said. What are you good at? Writing. And what are you good at writing about? Luke asked. Veronica thought for a second. Investigative journalism. I'm good at portraying people in a way that makes others understand them. Luke nodded. Yes, that's right. People are complex things. We have emotions running through us constantly, dominating our thoughts all day long. Animals do the same, but they lack the multitude of thoughts. Theirs are simple, so it's easier to understand them. You have a talent that allows people to understand the essence of others, to boil away all the thoughts and extraneous things so the masses can see inside someone. The surgeon sold so well not because you wrote about your experiences of being kidnapped and tortured. It certainly wasn't because you wrote about me. The book sold because you explained Bradley Brown's past in a way that made people understand him. And even though he was a monster, that's what people want. Do it again. It's that easy, huh? Just simply pick a man off the street and start writing about him. That'll be a bestseller, I'm sure. Luke smiled again. Well, there are interesting people out there. Many of them right around you. Name one. Christian Windsor. Veronica's head jerked backward at the name. At one point, they had discussed Christian frequently during therapy. How could they not? He was an intricate part of the whole Bradley Brown horror show. And a long time ago, Veronica had wanted Christian's help to prove Luke was a murderer. All of that was in the past now. Silly notions. What would I focus on if I wrote about him? He's a savant, but he hasn't done anything yet. He will, though. I can promise that. The problem is, Luke, I can't write about a man before he does something. No one wants a biography about that. Do you trust me, Veronica? She nodded. She trusted him implicitly, more so than perhaps anyone else in her life. Then talk to him. I think you'll find him a subject that the masses will want to learn about. Chapter 3. Just as 2 years passed for the others, they also passed for Lucy Speckle. She spent those 2 years becoming a model citizen, so to speak. No more outbursts. No more cursing or spitting. She came to realize that if she was ever to leave this place, all the non-essential things had to be essential. She even learned the name of where they kept her. Greenbrier Lakes. A great name despite the fact that there wasn't a lake anywhere around her. The subtitle, which sat on the sign outside, read, Where People Come to Recover. And that's what Lucy spent her 2 years doing, recovering. Christian Windsor was still out there, and God hadn't told her to do anything differently. The plan was clear, and so she needed to act as these people wanted her to. Lucy first worked on controlling her facial tics, the involuntary muscle spasms in her neck that caused her head to switch one way and the other, regardless of what was happening around her. She started working on speaking clearly, too, though both were extremely hard. There had been a time in Lucy's life when she wanted nothing more than to quit stuttering. First in school, and the kids that never stopped their torture. Her father, too. Sometimes at night when Lucy was deep in sleep, she could still see her father's face screaming at her, Stop your stuttering! Stop it, goddammit! She would cringe and cry, and eventually Daddy would make her repent for the stuttering. It used to bother her, because when you repent, God was supposed to forgive. God never forgave Lucy, though. Or if he did, he certainly didn't stop the stuttering. When Daddy died, Lucy quit caring about it, though. Daddy was the last essential person she knew. However, she needed to at least appear to be working on the stutter. Her review day had finally come, and this was why she had worked so hard. A chance for escape. For finding Christian Windsor. Lucy sat in Dr. Brigham's office. She had even spent the time to learn his first name, John. These things were essential if she was to get out. How's it going today, Lucy?
Good, she said, fighting the stutter that wanted to come out, turning good into good.
Lucy's file was open on Dr. Brigham's desk, but she didn't look down at it. It was only essential in that it would decide whether she left this place, but she knew how she acted was also essential. She couldn't pay too much attention to it. Today is your review day, you know that, right? She nodded.
Yes.
Short words helped keep the stuttering at bay. I've got to say, Lucy, I've been remarkably impressed with your change in behavior. You attend all therapy sessions. You have no angry outbursts. You're even running a Bible study, is that right? Another nod. Lucy kept her hands folded in her lap. The state remanded you to us after what happened at the woman's home. We've talked about that day a lot, haven't we?
Yes.
Of course they did. Lucy hated it when he spoke to her like a child. Do you think you'd ever do something like that again?
No, of course not. It was wrong.
A stutter. No more. No more. No more. Why?
Because I hurt people. A lot of them. I had no reason to hurt any of them, and I know that now. I can't let my anger out like that. It's not fair to them.
It's not fair to you either, Dr. Brigham said.
I know.
A long moment passed between Lucy and the doctor. He looked at her, and she kept her eyes firmly on him. She wouldn't look away because this was perhaps the most essential moment, a judgment day of sorts. I feel safe recommending that you leave, Lucy. Congratulations on such a remarkable recovery. I hope you understand how far you've come, and I truly hope you continue down this path you've set yourself on. Lucy smiled. The woman's home had been, by any measure, including Lucy's, a disaster, until the end. Then Lucy thought it turned out quite okay. She'd gone there after Daddy died, though not immediately. She tried to find work in her small southern town, but most people looked at her as a pariah. After what happened to her mother, and then the way Daddy died, no one was hiring her. She even went to the church. It was a small place, of course. Their religious convictions wouldn't never appeal to all those uppities, her father explained. Pastor Martin had said he was very, very sorry, but the church just couldn't take on anyone else. The budget was too tight as it was, and if he brought someone else on, he wouldn't be able to feed his own family. He said they'd take up an offering at Sunday service. He took up the offering, but Lucy never saw a nickel. And how much would she really have gotten from the 10 people sitting in the pews? So Lucy had left and headed to the only real city she knew about, Atlanta. She spent the first year working 2 or 3 part-time jobs, but she ran into problems. Lucy's tics and stutters kept her from being able to work most hospitality jobs, but those were the only places hiring someone with only a high school diploma from a town they never heard of. So, eventually, Lucy ended up in the women's shelter. She hated it from the get-go. She looked around and saw nothing but heathens. People on drugs or alcohol or having multiple kids out of wedlock. There were classes and therapists and everything else you could imagine. Her father had talked about it all before, the ills of society, as he termed it. The ills were people that couldn't take care of themselves and relied on drugs or booze to hide their failures from themselves. All them city folks gotta do is turn to the Lord. Once they do that, everything else'll be just fine. Lucy tried to preach to them, and when she did, her stutter disappeared. That was the miracle of God. While he may not have helped Lucy when Daddy told her to repent, as soon as she spoke about the Lord, the stutter couldn't be found. Her preaching went nowhere, and she was asked to stop by the staff. The moment which landed her in Greenbrier Lakes came shortly after that. She just hadn't been able to take it anymore, watching people around her destroying their lives, smoking their cigarettes, coming in from their jobs, and Lucy just knew they'd been at bars talking to men and getting loaded. Finally, she caught one of the women. Her name was lost in the recesses of Lucy's mind, if it had ever been there to begin with. Smoking those cigarettes. The body was a temple. The Lord made that clear. And here she was just destroying it. Destroying God's work. Lucy didn't think it was that big of a deal at the time. Certainly nothing like what God did to Sodom and Gomorrah. She just grabbed the cigarette from the woman's hand and put it out on her face. The woman shrieked and jerked back, but the red flesh still shone like a tiny sun on her skin. Lucy liked the way that felt, and she knew God liked her delivering a bit of justice. If they didn't respect their bodies, why should their flesh continue looking pristine as whores and drunks could look? Lucy started walking around the outside, pulling cigarettes from hands and simply grinding them out on whatever piece of the smoker she could get to. Hands, foreheads, eyes, mouths, she didn't care. She went through 7 people before the shrieks and cries finally alerted enough of the staff to come stop Lucy's righteous vengeance. She struggled hard against the men and women that came for her. Daddy had made sure Lucy was strong, and the muscle she gained back home, though lean and thin on her frame, never left. She punched, kicked, bit, and raked her nails every which way. Eventually, they brought her down to the ground. Her nose and mouth were bleeding, but she felt good for the first time in a long time. Daddy told her that God was just, but was also cruel to those who disregarded his laws. Lucy would never be the Lord's sword, but she'd done something good that day. The courts looked at it differently. They remanded her to Greenbrier Lakes with no apparent return to society date. Lucy went to court without saying a word in her defense. She essentially provided no defense, but the court found her incapable of determining right from wrong, a rarity as Lucy found out. Lucy knew right from wrong, though. It was the world that didn't understand the difference. Lucy quickly found out that being released from Greenbrier Lakes didn't mean complete freedom. She went to what was termed a halfway house, and if God had never tested her before, he was doing so now. This place was much worse than the women's shelter, but Lucy had to remember her goal. She had an important purpose, to usher in the Lord's sword. The halfway house got her a job as a maid at a local hotel. She went to it dutifully every day, speaking to almost no one. Her bosses stayed away for the most part, besides barking orders from time to time about something that needed cleaning. Lucy didn't really mind the work. She did it by herself, which she preferred. She folded towels, cleaned rooms, picked up used condoms and threw them away, scraped shit off the inside of toilets, everything that no one else in this horrible world wanted to do. But she did it because this wasn't the end for Lucy. It was the beginning. They allowed her to use the internet at the halfway house, and it took some time to first learn computers and then the internet. Lucy wasn't dumb by any means, but her life hadn't been cursed with such sophisticated technologies. Daddy said they were the devil's tool, and from what she found on them, she agreed. For her purposes, it wasn't essential that she know everything about the computer. She had to use something called a search engine. She needed Christian Windsor's name, which she had and would never, ever forget. Then she needed time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.